Let's start. Good morning and a very warm welcome to session on Atmanirbhar Bharat Manufacturing. The innovations in manufacturing sector will not only pave way for self-reliant India but also fructify Government of India's vision for being vocal for global, local and taking local to the global. In this transformational journey, it is the Indian MSME sector which contributes 30% of our GDP as a bedrock in making Bharat Atmanirbhar. Ladies and gentlemen, we are most delighted to have amongst us a visionary leader, a minister with an impeccable delivery track record, Shri Nitin Gadkari ji, Honorable Minister for Road Transport and Highways and MSME, to enlighten us with his views. I call upon FICCI President Dr. Sangeeta Reddy to please deliver the welcome remarks.
Namaste and good morning. Shri Nitin Gadkari ji, Honorable Minister of MSME, Road Transport and Highways. Mr. Harshpati Singhania, Past President FICCI. Mr. Subrakant Panda, Chairman FICCI Manufacturing Committee. Panelists, excellencies, members of the diplomatic corps, senior officials of the state and central government, industry, media, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor and a privilege to have you with us today, to have with us today a true visionary, Sri Nitin Gadkari ji, for this session on Atmanirbhar Bharat Manufacturing at the FICCI's 93rd Annual Convention. He's, of course, passionate about roads and a strong believer that roads are the gateway to prosperity. In addition, he's been instrumental in pushing the cause of Indian industry, infrastructure, and particularly MSME. According to a joint report by WTO and the World Bank, more than two-thirds of the world trade occurs through global value chains, and MSMEs worldwide are vital parts of these global value chains. Disruptions caused by COVID-19 have given an opportunity for the Indian MSME to integrate with the global value chains and rise. And in the words of our Honorable Prime Minister, whose inspirational address we just heard, we see this as an opportunity to make India an active manufacturing hub placed at the heart of global value chain and local, going local for global. Government has over the past few years announced many measures to support MSME, including the recent upward revision of the definition of MSME. We look forward to further deepening reforms to support our players, especially in terms of reducing compliance burden, cost of doing business, affordable testing, shared services, parks, and industrial parks, certification services, etc. As large companies continue to adopt new technologies of automation, AI, 3D printing, we need to ensure that our MSMEs are not left behind and seamlessly integrate with these so that they can also compete globally. We recently had a significant launch by the Honorable Prime Minister of the FICCI Expo. This is an annual expo which will connect small entrepreneurs from Tamil Nadu with buyers from Paris. It will connect sari weavers from Varanasi to buyers in New York. I now would like to request the Honorable Minister, Sri Nitin Gadkari ji, who we warmly welcome, to launch the FICCI CMSME toolkit created under the CMSME website. Nitin Gadkari ji, may I request you to please launch the website? Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to mention here that the FICCI CMSME body, whose representatives you just saw on the screen, it's an allied body which acts like the MSME arm of FICCI. We planned the online toolkit with an intent to provide all relevant information so that MSMEs can be informed about government schemes and policies. It will also act as a knowledge center, which will give handy information and guidance for a complete business cycle angle. We've also planned learning sessions under this. This was part of your initiative or guidance to us, and I'm happy we've been able to respond. I also want to acknowledge the presidium of CMSME, Mr. Narayanan, Mr. Girish Lutra, and Harjinder Kaur for their effort in putting this together, and the company Comvision of Harjinder, who actually did the work in a short period of time. Thank you, Honorable Minister Gadkariji, for launching this toolkit. This is just a beginning of our further multiple initiatives in strengthening MSME, as we are aware of their important role in building an Atmanirbhar Bharat. We welcome you to this session and are extremely grateful for your presence. Sri Nitin Gadkariji, for your address, please, sir.
Honorable Chairman P.K. Sangeeta Reddy, all respectable dignitaries, and dear friends, first of all, I am giving my special thanks to all of you, particularly the way in which for MSME you have taken initiative, and particularly the way in which in a modern concept you are presenting this tool to the MSME, which is very beneficial, and I am really glad, and I am giving my thanks to all of you. In Indian economy, MSME is the backbone of Indian economy. We contribute 30% of the GDP growth in the country. 48% of the export is from MSME. And up till now, we have created 11 crore jobs. So, government point of view, even nation point of view, our most important challenge is unemployment. And because of unemployment, we are facing the problem of poverty. And eradication of the poverty is the most important mission for the government. And if you want to eradicate the poverty, we need to develop employment potential in the country. I know that many of you are wealth creator and employment creator. And the employment creator is the most important as compared with the wealth creator is very important. But employment creator is more important than the wealth creator. Because the country is facing the problem of this poverty. And this is really a big challenge for the country. Now, as far as Indian situation, particularly our GDP is 14-16% from the agriculture sector. Our manufacturing sector is 22-26%, and service sector from 52-56%. Now, for development of our country to make India Atmanirbhar Bharat, we need to increase manufacturing sector up to 30%, and agriculture, at least we need to make it more than 25%. Agriculture and allied activities are very important. Now, presently in our economy, our big problem is the contribution in GDP from agriculture, rural and tribal, particularly 115 aspirant district, is very negligible. And that is one of the reason is our GDP is not exactly what we are expecting. So this is the time that we should have more concentration on agriculture, rural and tribal sector and 115 aspirant district. I'm giving you an example and I will request to all of you that today the village industry turnover is 80,000 crore last year up to the end of the March. And now next 2 years, my priority and my target is to make it 5 lakh crore. So exactly I need your cooperation that what are the raw material available, what are the skilled manpower is available, how we can develop agro-processing industries, even biofuel industry, where there is a place for employment and market. So exactly, we need to make two plans, one for urban India and one for rural India. Without developing rural India, we cannot get good record for which we are expecting for Atmanirbhar Bharat target. So my first request to all of you, to make Atmanirbhar India, the first important thing is the people, those who are socially, economically, educationally backward, where they are facing crucial economic problem, when there is a crisis for economic situation, also the crisis for actually they are facing poverty, and where we need to concentrate on Gaav, Garib, Mazdoor and Kisan. That is the highest priority for the government. And actually, whatever the problem we are facing in the urban area, it is because of migration. In Calcutta, Mumbai, Chennai, Bangalore, Delhi, everywhere, the urban population is increased, and because of that, total imbalance is there. In all Delhi places, we are facing the problem of air, water pollution, air pollution, lot of things that there, a congestion is there. And it is because of the thing that from last 30 years, 25 to 30% of the population is migrated from rural India to urban India. So exactly for Atmanirbhar Bharat, we need to plan in a two way. One is to rural India, another part is to urban India. My request to you about whatever the things which are already developed in micro, small industries and handloom handicrafts by Khadi Gramodyog. I am just giving an example. Like 2 days before, I checked a paint which is prepared by our scientist, which is from the cow, that gober, and that they make the process and done it very nicely. And it is to be tested in the laboratory. It is proved to be as long as whatever the good paints available in the market. I give you an example of Jaipur, where the plastic waste is added into the paper fiber and the handmade paper is prepared and the bags are tremendous demand are there. So there are a lot of things where we can create market. I always talking about it many times about biofuel. 8 lakh crore our import for crude oil. And today we have adding 10% ethanol in petrol. Our requirement is 450 crore liter. But still, for that 10% ethanol, we need 1600 crore liter. There is a short supply. Now we are now in the process to add 10% in diesel. Again, there will be requirement for 3000 crore liter. And already we have sanctioned the now flex engine, where in place of like USA, Canada and Brazil, you can use 100% petrol or 100% ethanol. So there will be a huge requirement. So we can make the biofuel economy of 2 lakh crore. Now we are allowing to make ethanol not only from sugarcane juice, molasses. Now we are BAB molasses. We are allowing making ethanol from corn, making ethanol from rice curd. Now the corn MSP is 1700 rupees per quintal and the market price is 1000 rupees per quintal. So if we can give permission, and already government has given the permission, you can make the plants in Bihar, UP, Haryana, Punjab, everywhere, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Maharashtra. We can convert corn into ethanol. It is import substitute, cost effective and pollution free. We don't have place for storing rice. We have a stock of 280 lakh ton of rice from last 3 years. We can supply rice to the whole world. So this is the time that we need to convert that rice into bioethanol, which is import substitute, cost effective and pollution free. Sangeeta ji, only we can develop the industry of 2 lakh crore in the rural area by making biofuel. I am now the member of FICCI, Praj Industries Pune. They have already completed their research making bio-aviation fuel from ethanol. And Air Force has sanctioned that, and already 16 countries have cleared it, that we can use this fuel, bio-aviation fuel from ethanol in our aircrafts. So it is import substitute, cost-effective, pollution-free, and economics is there. Here is a field, there is a chance. I remember 2 days before I have an interaction with the FICCI in one of the programs, that electric car, electric bike, electric buses we are making. But it is up to you that you can make the research and study what are the parts which are manufactured in India and what are the parts which are imported. Now the magnet, there are a lot of things we are imported from the China. I am seeing, I am not a businessman or as a business expert, But I'm seeing a huge potential for electric car, electric bike, electric school, auto rickshaw, and electric truck, electric buses. Now, 2 days before, I have interaction with the MD of Mercedes-Benz. He was telling me they are planning to launch electric truck. So there is a public transport system. We need that trolley buses, double-decker buses on electricity, point-to-point. Huge potential is available. But the people, expert people like you, if you can work with the automobile industry, particularly those who are working for electric vehicles, that what are you are importing and what are you are making? If lithium ion battery, the magnet and other thing, whatever the thing which we are importing, we should have to find out the Swadeshi alternative in the country without compromise with the quality and the cost. That is exactly the main mission of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So hundreds of fields and sectors are there where you can find out this requirement. And there you have to inspire and motivate to the people in the direction that we need to reduce our import and increase our export. And exactly by this way, we can make our economy strong. We can increase our growth rate. And we can even increase manufacturing sector from 22 to 30%. And here we need to upgradation of the technology. Whatever the new innovation, research and technology available with the Indian IITs, engineering colleges, our research institution, we can use it. Actually, when I discuss with the research making by the Defense Ministry, I request them, why you are taking all this research into safe deposit vault? Take it to the people. Give it to the people. This is the time that we should popularize our research to the common man, where the common people can take the advantage of it, and by which they can develop the many things. So knowledge is the power. Innovation, entrepreneurship, science, technology, research, skill, and successful practices, we name it as a knowledge. And as conversion of knowledge into wealth is the future. My suggestion to all of you, that you divide all this mission into different parts. And first find out who are the main stakeholders for automobile sector. First of all, just make the research and study what are the things they are importing. Then find out how we can make available all these things manufactured in India, that is made in India and make in India. Then find out what are the problems they are facing because of government policies. Let us put up all this problem to us. Whatever the problem, they are related with the technology. If there is a research in India, they can use it. If it is not there, they can make the upgradation by making joint venture with the technology which is available in the global world, so they can make it. The people are ready to invest in India. The other important thing is the liquidity is a big problem. I know that we are some problem that the Reserve Bank have got 9 lakh crore deposited by the banks getting 2% interest. We are trying. Prime Minister is telling to them, they use it for the people. Finance it to the people. Now, by a whole way, the financial institution, we need liquidity in the market. Without liquidity, we cannot increase the growth rate. And without growth rate, we cannot get capital investment and we cannot increase the employment potential. And without employment potential, we cannot eradicate poverty. And without that, we cannot make Atmanirbhar Bharat. So, exactly my request is, in the different fields, where we need to operate in a way, first of all, you decide what is the responsibility of the government and different government departments where you are expecting change in policies. Suppose we have changed the definition of MSME now. We have taken a lot of decision. We are open-minded. Any type of good suggestion from your side, we are ready to sit with you. We are ready to discuss with you. And our simple formula is convince me or convince by me. If you convince us, my secretary and myself, we will do it. So we are transparent, time-bound, result-oriented and corruption. Our commitment is for Atmanirbhar Bharat. Make Indian economy globally strong. And that is exactly, you are the wealth creator, you are the employment creator, and entrepreneurship is very important. Unfortunately, we have the Institute of Financial Management, Institute of Administration, Institute of Human Management, but we don't have Institute of Entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurship is more important than technology and resources. We have to develop entrepreneurship. And for that reason, we need to develop an appropriate leadership in the business circle by which they can be employment creator. And where my request is to create maximum employment potential into rural India. So on that line, somewhere we need to prepare a transparent, time-bound, result-oriented, appropriate vision by which we can inspire and motivate all the stakeholders in the direction of Atmanirbhar Bharat. I know that presently we are facing the problem because of COVID-19. I know that the economy is also facing the problem. But we need positivity and self-confidence by which I am confident that 100% we are going to win this war against COVID-19 and economic war. Regarding role of the FICCI and the institute like FICCI, I really appreciate your role. But one thing which I will request you that you should go into the details. Without that, we cannot get appropriate policy, sector to sector. What are the things which are already countries importing where you have to find out the way out? I am giving you the example of agarbatti sticks. We have taken decision. We have charged more duty on the agarbatti imported from abroad. Now today the agarbatti industry is developed. Now they are problem. They don't have that bamboo. So we are developing that type of bamboo in the area. So my suggestion is in that line, we are firstly all committed as a stakeholder for Atmanirbhar Bharat. The inspiration and motivation, which is already there, given by the Prime Minister. And I feel that the government is with you. We are open-minded. We are ready to compromise for anything. If anything wrong from our side, we will change the policies. We are ready to cooperate you. If the support of the Finance Ministry also, if you need some cooperation, we can request Nirmala ji also to change the policy. We can approach to the Prime Minister. And already because of COVID and economic situation, hundreds of decisions are taken by the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister, and we are implementing. We have taken a lot of decisions related with the agriculture, fishing, food processing industries. We are taking for small-scale industries. We changed the definition. We have sanctioned the loans, 3 lakh crores for that. 1,80,000 crores already disbursement is going on. So we are now making the MSME, those who are having a good track record, particularly from the bank, income tax, and bank turnover. We are make their rating, and we have 20,000 crore with us, fund of fund. And we will take 15% equity in that industry. They will go to the capital market and they will raise the fund. They don't need to take the fund from anybody in financial institution. So already there are a lot of capable MSMEs. Their profits are good. Their financial records are good. Their GST records are good. Bank records are good. So this type of good industry MSME, where we are ready to support them as a 15%, whatever the equity they are going to raise, 15% will be given by the government. And my idea is, again, that 15% after 3 years, we will sell that. Again, add it to other. And by the way, we can make it this equity fund of 1 lakh crore. I'm giving an example. In NHI, my total income was 24,000 crore last year. Even in big COVID also, because of fast track and other thing, at the end of March, it will be 34,000 crore. Within 5 years, we are going to make it 1 lakh crore. And 1 lakh crore when income will be there, then you understand 1 lakh crore presently my budget. At that time, after 3-4 years, it will be 1,40,000 from the government and 1 lakh from my income. 2,50,000 crore with us every year. And because of that, I can raise the fund. And I can make the roads of more than 15 lakh crore. I can create jobs. I can create even the equipment manufacturing industries. Now they increase their productivity by double. Now the steel, cement, one thing which I will request you. Now the cement, the steel rates are increased in last 6 months by 55%. I never understand what is the power rise, what is the raw material rise. Somewhere you have to make a policy that we are supporting the industry, but they are taking the advantage of the situation. This is not correct. I decided to make all concrete road and 40% of cement has consumed by my department. But the cement industry, I want to encourage them. But they're taking the advantage of the situation, making the cartel and increase the rate. So I am now allowing that go for bitumen, no problem. So somewhere I need cooperation from your side. You earn profit, no problem. Every businessman has a fundamental right to earn the profit. You are not a charitable organization. I am not expecting from that. But we should have some policy, some reasonability. by which we can go ahead, even we can increase our business. So that is the reason that in Atmanirbhar Bharat, by considering the problems of all stakeholders, the way in which you are planning for that, you can divide it into 20 parts, 30 parts, 40 parts. Then you can make a study of our imports. Then you can make the study that how we can increase our exports. We are want to reduce the logistic cost, labor cost and power cost. For that reason, we want to help you. We are now making waterways. We are making in the infrastructure of what international standard. 111 lakh crore in 5 years, we are planning to spend on infrastructure. And actually in the road construction, we are making 22 green express highway. We can take from Mumbai to Delhi within 12 hours by car and 18 hours by truck. So your business cost will be reduced. We are now planning to use LNG as a fuel for long term, CNG for short term. We are using biofuel, using ethanol. Then we are now, I am also going to launch a tractor on 100% bio-CNG and making bio-CNG from biomass. How to create more employment potential, how to resolve the problem of pollution, where the parali is a waste material creating pollution in Delhi. We are now planning to use parali for making bio-CNG. So different type of research, innovations are there, and knowledge is the power. And by making, divide this policy into the different parts, we can make a plan, a agenda, a action plan, and by which you fix the role. What is the role of ministry, different ministry? What is the role of industry? And in a way in which we will cooperate you. And I am confident that still we are some problems we are facing, but I am very much positive and optimistic. In due course of time, we will win this war and we will resolve the problem. And 100% a vision, which is very important, where the inspiration, motivation is already given by the people like you. I really giving my thanks to FICCI for arranging this program. And from my ministry, we will all cooperate you. Whatever the good suggestion from your side, we will 100% consider that, and we will rectify the policy, and we will be very friendly for you for the making this mission, complete this mission of Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is really a dream of our Prime Minister. We will 100% fulfill that, and we will try for that. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Namaskar, sir. You are always a powerhouse of ideas, energy, and the implementation capacity. May I now request our senior past president, Mr. Ashpati Singhania, to give a formal vote of thanks. But once again, on FICCI commit, sir, we're working in all these areas. On the electric vehicle, we'll present you a report. One of our own members has completely re-engineered to create a Atmanirbhar electric vehicle. On biogas, we will give you a paper shortly. So the FICCI team is completely committed to your ideology. Thank you so much for your presence. Over to you, Ashpati Singhania ji.
थैंक यू संगीता. नमस्कार गडकरी जी. थैंक यू और बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपके ट्रूली इंस्पायरिंग एड्रेस का. हमारी फिक्की की इस एजीएम की थीम है इंस्पायर्ड इंडिया. आई थिंक एवरीबॉडी विल एग्री विद मी हियर दैट हैव रियली इंस्पायर्ड नॉट ओनली द एमएसएमई सेक्टर बट ऑल बिजनेस पीपल. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर. Sir, you talked about Atmanirbhar Bharat, and I am very happy to tell you that this morning, the very example that you took about this ethanol and biofuel, the Honorable Prime Minister also in his opening remarks talked of this very point. So obviously there is a huge opportunity. This is just an example of the huge opportunity that exists before us. You've also touched on the agro-processing industries, and the fact that we need to look at rural and agricultural areas in a new light and link them with the entire urban chain. So, sir, I think that is, you have put out very logically, point by point, how we can grow our economy to a $5 trillion economy by linking the various areas. And, sir, from FICCI, we deeply appreciate particularly your repeated remarks today about saying that we are open to change, and if there are issues, please come and talk to us. And therefore, we want to thank you very much for this. And I like your philosophy that either we convince you or you convince us. So thank you once again, sir, for coming to FICCI on behalf of all our members and particularly our MSME participants. We look forward to working with you very closely and building our nation to realize what it can. Bahut bahut dhanyavaad, Gadkari ji, and namaskar. Namaskar. Friends, from here, I'd like to move on immediately as we have constraints for our next speaker, Amitabh Kanji. Amitabh ji, a very warm welcome to you from on behalf of FICCI. Great to see you here. And as you all know, he doesn't need much introduction, but he's the CEO of Niti Aayog and has also been a key architect of many of the major flagship schemes of the government of India, like Make in India, Startup India, even in the earlier periods of Incredible India, and most recently with closely being involved with the PLI or the Production Linked Incentive Scheme, which is a path breaking scheme. In fact, the Prime Minister of India, you were there, also spoke about this at length in his address this morning to FICCI. So this has, and you have now expanded the scheme to include many more sectors, and you are now in 10 sectors, whether they are batteries, electronics, pharma, auto, food processing, telecom, much beyond the original electronic sector that you had taken on. So the large opportunities that will exist for not only making Indian business competitive, but also looking at the huge export potential that can come out of this scheme is what we want to understand from you. So thank you very much for being here. We want to, we'd love to hear your views on the PLI and the other initiatives the government is taking under the Atmanirbhar scheme. After that, we have a couple of our senior industry leaders who will talk about how PLI can help them in their sectors in agro processing and in electronics. So Amitabh ji, welcome and over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Singhania. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, let me be extremely focused on the production linked incentive scheme, which actually started off with the mobile and electronic manufacturing sector, and which we have now taken to another 10 sectors. We had extended it to active pharmaceutical ingredients and to medical devices and the pharma sector, but we are now expanded it to about 10 sectors. The objective was to provide a major impetus to manufacturing and exports. And this, to my mind, is one of the biggest schemes which the government has come out to provide support to the private sector in manufacturing. It's a $26 billion scheme, which provides production linked incentive in the 10 champion sectors. And, you know, as I said, $26 billion means 2 lakh crores. So we started off with mobile, and when we did the mobile scheme, it was a resounding success. We've got all the top manufacturers of Apple, Wistron, Pegatron, Foxconn, all who've relocated and are coming into India. Samsung is also invested in India and is now expanding in a very big way. But we've also supported Indian manufacturers. The objective is that this is the time when supply chains across the world will get relocated. And this is an opportunity for India to really take the opportunity to see that many manufacturers who'd gone to different destinations relocate their manufacturing to India. And that is why we focused on this particular scheme. It's a very big game changer for these sectors. And you know, the in objective is that major global companies as well as Indian companies should apply under the scheme. These 10 sectors will play a major role in making Indian manufacturers globally competitive, will attract investment. Our hope is that they should attract investments on a large scale. They should be able to boost our export potential. and actually give rise to economies of scale. And we should be able to produce cutting-edge products and solutions that will ensure our integration into the global value chains. What quite often we do in India is to focus on sunset areas of industries, and it's then very difficult to penetrate emerging areas of growth. Just to give you the example, that 70% of our export, actually 73 to 74% of our exports, is in areas where the world market is just 30%. 70% of the market is in areas where India has very little, minuscule production. And therefore, even if you try very hard, you can keep trying harder and harder in very many areas like food processing and textiles, etc. But you will not be able to become a global exporter. And therefore, there are cutting edge areas, there are the sunrise areas of growth where India must get in and ride the wave of growth. And therefore, if you look at what we've done is the production linked incentive for electronic technology products. We focused on new areas of growth, IoT devices, computer hardware, servers. And in the PLI for advanced cell chemistry battery manufacturing is actually a massive opportunity for us to look at areas of consumer, not merely consumer electronics, but also in the faster adoption of electric vehicles and renewable energy solutions. Because batteries will be required for both mobility as well as for grid solutions. And it should bring major domestic and international players to establish competitive and efficient manufacturing landscape in India. Similarly, as we head towards 5G, we should be able to build a secured and advanced telecom infrastructure, and we need to become a major original equipment manufacturer of telecom and networking product. So the PLI for telecom infrastructure should attract large investments from global and Indian players to ramp up our capabilities of domestic manufacturing. The reason for PLI is that quite often, if you go back and look at the MEIS sector, we were supporting almost 90% of the product lines. We were supporting 90% of the product lines. We were supporting about close to 82% of our exporters. But the MEIS item exports did not grow. Actually, the non-MEIS analysis showed that the non-MEIS items were growing. And therefore, if you want size and scale of manufacturing, and without getting the size and scale of manufacturing, India can never be a global champion. And therefore, if you want size and scale of manufacturing, India should be able to support the size and scale for a period of 5 years. So what we are saying is that if you are producing X this year, if you're producing 1,000, next year you produce 1,500, we'll support you for 500 additionality. If you produce 2,000, we'll produce support you for the next 1,000. If you produce 2,500, we'll support you for the next 1,500. We'll keep supporting you for the next 5 years. And in the 5 years, the company should be able to become so big, so large, that they should be able to provide all the backward forward linkages, and they should be growing so big and large in size that they should become a very integral part of the global supply chain. And that is the philosophy behind this. So logically, if you look at it, the $26 billion that the government should put in, and the scheme is so defined that we will support after the production has taken place. You keep growing bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger in size and scale, and we'll support you for the additionality of the production. And therefore, this $26 billion that we will support you for should logically, we've done our calculations, should lead to an increased production of 520 billion in India in the next 5 years through this scheme. If you are not able to increase, then the government outgo will not take place. If you are able to meet the challenge and grow, then, you know, the government will provide you this $26 billion.
So this is a very focused scheme. It is not an investment scheme. It is not an investment subsidy scheme. For the first time, the government has moved away from supporting capital expenditure for at the investment stage to saying that you increase production. Whatever you do, you just increase production. You keep increasing production, we will support you. And therefore, in addition to that, we've looked at areas of solar PV, again, cutting edge technology areas, which can build large scale solar PV capacity in India, which we've been importing. We have looked at PLI scheme for many other sectors like steel, advanced high value steel. We've looked at pharma, where India is already a major manufacturer. And we looked at auto components. In fact, the outlay for auto components is amongst the highest, because we very strongly feel that India is already in the value chain in auto components, and it can become a very big global player. But we've also supported labor intensive areas like food processing and textiles, and white good areas like air conditioners and LED. So our objective is that these schemes will not only provide a huge fillip to these sectors, but they will also create backward linkages with MSMEs, because when the large companies become big, they will, after all, have tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 suppliers, and there will be backward linkages with MSME, and there will be an overall multiplier impact on the Indian economy. It should increase our resilience and self-reliance, while at the same time lead to massive value creation and projecting us as a favorable investment destination. So I just want to say that the sectors are really advanced chemical, cell, battery, electronic technology products, automobile, auto components, pharmaceuticals and drugs, telecom networking products, textile products, MMF segment and technical textiles, food processing and high efficiency solar PV modules, white goods, ACs and LED and specialty steel. So just 10 sectors where India must become a global champion, where India must become a global champion. India must become a global champion and become a major player in the global industry. That is our objective. And with this few words, our view is that this should become a key driver of manufacturing. All the schemes are at their very advanced stage, the ones for electronic, and for manufacturing and mobile, active pharmaceutical ingredients, pharma sector have already been announced, and the others are at very advanced stage. They are going through the process of approval. The umbrella scheme was approved by the cabinet. All others are getting approved. Now, when you look at this PLI scheme with GST, with very competitive rates of taxation, with IBC, etc., our objective is that government has taken a series of measures to make India highly competitive in the global economy. And this 5 years of support should really spur growth in manufacturing in a very, very big way. And the only two challenges that we have in the manufacturing sector are now bringing down the cost of logistics, on which we are working, and discoms, because I feel that the cost of power for manufacturing industrial consumers is still high compared to other countries, which needs to be brought down, on which we are working. The government has already announced a privatization of discom schemes for union territories. And governments like Orissa have moved forward, and I think this should spur a new initiative for greater efficiency of the DISCOMs. But with this scheme there, for the next 5 years, we are taking care of all the any kind of, we've compared all these areas with global benchmarking we've done. So in certain areas, we are giving 6%, 7% support. Certain areas, we are giving 5%. But on average, it works out to 5%. And that is about $26 billion. So with these few words, I'll conclude. If there's any question, I'll be very happy to respond.
Thank you so much, Mr. Amitabh Kanji. As always, you bring in a huge amount of enthusiasm and energy, and very much in consonance with Fiki's theme of being inspired India. You have explained in great detail, and I think we look forward in industry to working closely with you as we move along. If we have any issues that come up, we will certainly interact with you. Just if I may just say that we have with us two people from key sectors that can take on, and if you might want to hear them for a few minutes, it would be very helpful. So may I with that invite Mr. Hemant Mallick, who is the Divisional Chief Executive of Foods Business of ITC. And then, of course, I'll ask Mr. Sunil Vachani, who is the Chairman of Dixon Technologies, to come in later on. Just a few minutes. Mr. Mallick.
Yes, sir.
One second.
Very good afternoon, and thank you for this opportunity that has been given to me to speak in this occasion. And since the morning, after having listened to the Prime Minister, sorry, so there's an echo that I'm getting.
Yeah, that'll come, but you please carry on.
Okay. And Prime Minister's whole call on Atmanirbhar Bharat, and right now Mr. Amitabh Kant's very inspired, strong comments on PLI, and the way we look at it is Atmanirbhar is not only about, it's not about isolation, it's about self-reliance. It's about using domestic resources of both man and material. It's about creating internal competencies to leverage innovation, and it's about competing in the global market. I believe that with digitization and technology, I think it gives a level playing field, because India would be as smart as any other manufacturing area to actually start off from there. There is an opportunity for us to create Indian global brands and make from local to global and drive entrepreneurship. I think all this is going to create this virtual cycle, and this virtual cycle is actually started by the PLI scheme that has been announced. I'm representing the food processing team, and needless to say, and we heard a lot from Mr. Nitin Gadkari also from the agro part of it. As far as India is concerned, we all know it is the second highest agri producer in the world, it's got the second largest arable land, but it has only less than 10% of the food which is processed. When I were to compare with countries like Malaysia, Indonesia and Philippines, you find that 90% plus is into packaged form. So there is this opportunity, and food processing very clearly sits in the intersection of both agriculture and manufacturing. And we believe that India can become the world's food factory. It is, as sir you said, it is also one of those sunrise industry. From an employment generation perspective, it has got the highest employment to capital ratio. And when you're talking about the PLI scheme, we believe that for every crore invested, the number of employment that this sector can generate is on the highest order. It has the highest number of factories operation across all registered industries. And we believe that the multiplier impact that will happen through food processing is going to be immense for the economy. In terms of value addition, as I talked about, the value addition at this point of time is not very high from the food processing, and that is an opportunity area for us. Having said that, I believe COVID has had a very positive impact as far as consumer behavior is concerned. Today, people, from the need of hygiene, there is a movement towards packaged branded product. There is an importance of trust mark. There is an importance of the fact that this product has been signed off by FSSAI. And that is going to also make a significant difference to this sector. More importantly, sir, food, there is an immense opportunity from export perspective as well. The global food processing market is all going to be $4.1 trillion by 2024. It is an exciting opportunity for us to expand manufacturing base. There is opportunity from taking up both the ready-to-eat food products, but at the same time, if you were to take an example of how Peru marketed quinoa and suddenly it became into every shelf, into every household's breakfast table, I believe there are a lot of Indian cereals which can actually be converted into different products and marketed, and millets is one big example. And the support that will come in, I think, will make a difference in terms of how we can take Indian food globally. There will be a need, sir, in terms of building Indian brand, Indian quality, and that will be a support that if it can come into the industry, that will be extremely helpful. Sir, you talked about the frozen supply chain, the agri wastages that we have been seeing. There is an incentive which is coming from cold chain perspective, but there is an opportunity to take this straight up to the retail outlet, because finally the consumer is going to buy from the outlet. And if that is where the frozen products are available, I think that it will make very helpful for the supply chain and the 92,000 crore of agri wastages that we're talking about to get addressed. Sir, I work with from wheat and spices value chain to potato value chain for our snack products. And we believe, like, if you look at snacks, there is a chip grade potato which gives much higher value to the farmer, and that can be expanded across different geographies of the country so that the logistic cost can actually get minimized. Fruit and vegetable value chain, sir, we have a brand Be Natural, and we have been focusing only on domestic fruits because we believe that if Indian processing works on domestic fruits in the form of, because right now the import duties are much lower on some of these fruit concentrate that get imported, but there's an opportunity to agree to actually grow this case. Finally, sir, in terms of the PLI scheme, as you mentioned, sir, we are very grateful that food has been included. We have, the food industry has worked very closely with MOFPI, and they have taken a lot of inputs from us. We are very happy to see it is outcome focused. So therefore, we have to deliver, the industry has to deliver to take advantage of the scheme, and which therefore is actually a win-win solution. From food processing, as I mentioned about the opportunity of driving employment. Couple of comments on that, sir, which is coming in from the industry. Which is about how do you broad-base the processed food in terms of which other sectors that can be included into the PLI scheme. And it will be helpful to actually look at what are the large categories of foods today and to support them, because that is where the early investment will actually start from. There's an opportunity to actually increase the minimum investment threshold so that only large players who are serious about it will get focusing on that. And as I mentioned, sir, there's an opportunity to help build India brand in the export market. We believe that with the kind of food products, agro produce that happens, we can actually not only sell the Indian food, but we can actually look at how to look at the food which is sold globally, and that can be produced in the Indian market. So with those words, thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Malik, for sharing your views on and thoughts on the food sector. May I now invite Mr. Sunil Vachani, who is the chairman of Dixon Technologies, which you know is very much involved in the electronic sector. Mr. Vachani, please.
Thank you. Firstly, I would like to thank Mr. Amit. This path-breaking scheme, I would say this PLI scheme, that is his brainchild and the brainchild of Niti Aayog. Why I call it path-breaking and a game changer, like he also said, many reasons. I think first, it checks all the boxes that it was supposed to. The first being, it creates a huge amount of scale in the country for the products that are selected. So if I give you the example of mobile phones, the investments committed are almost 1 lakh crore and turnover almost 11 lakh crore in the next 5 years. I think this will make India the largest manufacturer of mobile phones in times to come. I'm very confident of that. Second, I think it creates a very strong component ecosystem which was missing. So far, if we see in products like LED televisions and also mobile phones, we were importing a lot of components. And I think a positive part is that a lot of the components have also been included in this PLI scheme. So we will see, I think, in times to come, a very strong component ecosystem also being developed. Three, I think it also helps, and this is the objective, one of the objectives of the policy, is build Indian champions. We know there is a parallel track for Indian companies as well as multinational companies. So I think a path has been clearly defined for Indian companies to emerge global players and global champions in times to come. But I think the biggest thing that it has brought about, the PLI scheme, is the change in mindset of Indian entrepreneurs. I think Indian manufacturers now believe that they can overcome all disabilities with this PLI scheme. They now believe that we can compete in the global markets with against anybody, and they now believe that we can truly become global champions. And to me, I think that is the biggest change that this PLI scheme has brought about. Sir, having been one of the applicants ourselves, a successful applicant for mobile phones, and now hopefully for LED lighting and maybe for laptops in times to come, I can say that the execution has been amazing. It has been seamless. But just a few suggestions, sir, for further PLIs which might come in the near future. One is, sir, I think that while the execution has been seamless, I think we need to ensure that the dispersals of the amounts committed under the PLI also need to be very smooth, because this will really encourage the players who are sitting on the sidelines to come and invest large amounts into the PLI scheme. Two, sir, I think the way the scheme is structured right now, there is a slight tilt towards new players coming into the sector versus the established players. So just to give you an example, the whole scheme works on a threshold revenue on the base year, which in this mobile case was financial year 1920. And in LED it'll be lighting, it'll be 2021. So it basically, a company which is a lower turnover, sir, for them to cross the threshold turnover with a, let's say, 100 crore turnover, it's much easier to cross the threshold turnover as compared to a company which already has a large turnover, let's say 5,000 crores. So one of the suggestions is, sir, that for future policies, what we could do is that we have a minimum threshold defined wherein the company has to achieve that turnover to start getting the incentives. What this will also achieve is that a level playing field between the new players and the incumbents. And it'll also ensure that the medium, small and medium players also have a certain amount of scale and do become global champions in times to come. Sir, I would just like to say that for the Indian industry, 5 years is not a very long time. I think for what we need to ensure now is that we are competitive without any incentives in times to come. And I think all of us in the industry will be working very, very hard towards it. But I think, sir, it's also important that some of the disability factors that the PLI is compensating go away. Sir, you very rightly talked about some of the factors like the high power cost, that how some of the states are going to be hopefully capping the power cost for some of the sectors, and high logistics costs. But sir, one of the big disabilities is the interest cost that we have in the system, the high cost of interest. And even though we have the interest subvention scheme for exports, the interest subvention scheme is really compensating just the direct exporter. So sir, suggestion is that can we look at a scheme which compensates for the high interest cost to the entire value chain? So what I'm suggesting, sir, is something like an ARO scheme, which was the advanced release order and the advanced license, wherein the exporter who applied for the advanced license, his entire value chain, that means his suppliers, could get the ARO and could import material duty free. So if something like that could be worked out for the sectors that we're talking about, this would ensure that we do not export our high interest costs in times to come. Sir, I would just like to say I'm extremely confident that with this PLI scheme, India will emerge the hub for manufacturing of mobile phones, LED lighting products, and the other ICT products that you have introduced us for. And just to close, sir, I would just like to end with a couplet, I think, which really reflects the mood of the nation and our mood in the industry. And it says, abhi zindagi ki asli udaan baki hai, abhi zindagi mein kai imtihan baki hai, abhi to napi hai zameen humne, abhi pura aasman baki. So with these words, sir, thank you once again for this path-breaking and game-changer scheme. And like I said, we in the industry would work very hard to ensure that India does become the hub for manufacturing of these products. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vachani, for sharing your thoughts and your suggestions. May I now invite Mr. Shahrukh Khan Panda, who is our key manufacturing committee, to wrap up this session, sir.
Thank you. At the outset, I would like to thank Mr. Amitabh Kant for not just an absolutely inspiring address, but also sitting through the rest of the session and taking in the comments by our industry leaders. I think that is a sign of this government being responsive to inputs and saying that we are doing our whatever we can, but we are always willing to listen to further inputs on how to fine tune the approach. I think from that point of view, the theme of FICCI's annual convention, which is Inspired India, is very appropriate in my opinion, because we are looking to take the adversity which we saw in perhaps the first half of the year due to the COVID situation and see how we can turn it into opportunity. No less a person than the Prime Minister, when he makes an emphatic statement that we have missed the manufacturing bus once, but this time we will do whatever it takes for India to be a part of the global supply chain, I think it's very reassuring. And that was also the sentiment that Amitabh Ji touched upon when he said that the idea of the PLI scheme is to be extremely focused, to take to pick the champion sectors which can actually deliver growth, because for too long we have talked about we want to increase the share of manufacturing, and lo and behold, a year, 2 or 3 years later, we see that we are where we have always been, around that 15-16% mark. But I'm convinced that this is with the focused approach that we are looking at, with the concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is not just for domestic consumption, which is of course a huge market, especially an integrated market post implementation of GST, but to look to make India an export hub. And in that context, I think the game changer scheme, which is what has been referred to as PLI, and I must confess that I was aware of the scale of the scheme in terms of it being $26 billion, but the translation of that to a little more than $500 billion of manufacturing turnover was something which came as a surprise. And I think that is very, very critical for us to move up to what we aspire. And indeed, manufacturing has to grow significantly for us to become a $5 trillion economy, as has been articulated by the Honorable Prime Minister. So we heard from the industry leaders in two sectors which are going to benefit from the PLI scheme. And I think the key takeaway from there is the change in mindset, because for the longest period of time, we have looked at Indian entrepreneurs being defensive, but this is giving us the opportunity to bat on the front foot, so to say. And I think perhaps that's also a sort of a good point to make when India is touring Australia, and there's going to be a lot of bounces being bowled. But I think it's the confidence that this scheme gives us as entrepreneurs, which is what we look forward to. And suffice it to say that I'm confident that the pandemic-related hiccups are going to be a thing of the past soon, and GDP growth will get back to being on the required trajectory. And more importantly, or more specifically, as far as this session is concerned, that manufacturing will firmly be on a footing to get to 20-25% or perhaps even more of GDP. And what better can we ask for when we are on the cusp of 75 years of independence? So with that, I would like to thank all of you for sparing time for this session. It's been an eye opener for me, and I'm sure everyone has enjoyed the varied inputs that have come in. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Amitabh.
Thank you, Mr. Vachani and Mr. Malik. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Amitabh ji. Great to have you here, Shiki. Thanks.
Thank you, Amitabh ji. Outstanding as always.
Thank you, Sangeeta, and wish you all the very best. You've been an outstanding president of FICCI. Thank you so much.
Truly, truly appreciate it. Thank you, sir.